This week, the best movies of the year, our top five and Rogers.
And our picks for the worst movie of the year. Hello and welcome to our special show, the best and worst movies of the year. We're covering the highs and the lows. I'm Ignatiy Vishnevetsky of Mubi.com.
And I'm Christy Lemire of the Associated Press. Let's get to it. My pick at number five is Bellflower, an ultra-low-budget tale of toxic romance that's one of the most wildly creative movies to come along in a while. In his feature debut, Evan Glodell directed, wrote, co-produced, co-edited, and stars as Woodrow. He's sort of a slacker dude who spends his days building muscle cars and flamethrowers in preparation for a Mad Max-style apocalypse. He gets help from his best friend, Aiden, played by a hugely charismatic Tyler Dawson.
Here you go, Commander.
Oh, perfect. I feel much better now. All right, here goes.
But then Woodrow falls in love with an impossibly cool girl he meets at a bar. And then things start getting really weird. Bellflower morphs right before your eyes from a sweet, delicate romance to something darker and more dangerous. You begin to wonder what's real and what's imagined as the film reaches its explosive conclusion. It's a daring piece of filmmaking. Glodell even built the camera used to create the movie's dramatic, oversaturated look. He's an exciting young filmmaker to watch. And number four, my pick is The Tree of Life. Terrence Malick's gorgeous, ambitious, maddening attempt at depicting nothing less than the origin of the universe. It encompasses everything from dinosaurs to small-town family life to the cosmos. It's like nothing else you have ever seen, and it will change your mood long after it's done. Brad Pitt gives one of the best performances of his career as a stern husband and father of three in 1950s Texas. And Jessica Chastain is lovely as his playful, doting wife. Malick's film is deeply spiritual, but he isn't one to preach. He ranges far and wide, offering an intriguing contrast between heavy, eternal concepts and prosaic childhood memories. Flashbacks come in light, wispy snippets of sight and sound, of trees and sky and grass, of a mother's voice. These moments are intentionally impressionistic, and The Tree of Life feels defiantly plotless and sometimes self-indulgent. But if you're open to letting the imagery wash over you, to letting yourself get sucked into the film's rhythms and undulating tones, you'll be amazed.
You know, I can't say that I agree with your choice of Bellflower. I personally did not like that film. Ugh. But one thing we do agree on, though, is that The Tree of Life is one of the best films of the year. Mm-hmm. I put Terrence Malick's ambitious family drama in my number five spot. What I really like about the movie is how Malick chooses to emphasize mundane moments and details, which gives The Tree of Life a sense of energy and urgency. The camera weaves in and out of rooms and catches stray rays of light. But what comes through most vividly in this movie is Malick's overall vision. I pick for the fourth best film of the year is, to my mind, one of the most romantic films of the last decade, even though the two main characters never as much as kiss. In Certified Copy, Juliette Binoche and the opera singer William Schimmel play two people who appear to meet for the first time at the beginning of the film and engage in a flirtatious game where they pretend to be husband and wife over the course of a long afternoon in Tuscany. Mind you, the key word is appear, because we're never completely sure whether they really don't know each other, are merely pretending not to know each other, or whether there's another more complicated side to their relationship that we don't fully understand.
Tu es une vraie connaisseuse d'art, n'est-ce pas?
Je ne vois pas comme une œuvre d'art. C'est son sujet qui me plaît que j'aime.
Son sujet?
J'aime la façon dont elle posait sa tête sur son épaule.
C'est incroyable que tu peux être si fleur bleue.
Et toi, c'est incroyable que tu sois si irresponsable.
These complex head games wouldn't work if it weren't for the two great lead actors. This is Binoche's finest performance, requiring her to explore a lot of complicated emotional terrain. And Schimmel, making a screen debut, is a perfect counterpart. The film was directed by the great Abbas Kiarostami. It's the first non-documentary film he's made outside of his native Iran, and his deft handling of the multilingual cast just shows what a master he is when it comes to filmmaking.
Yeah, Juliette Binoche is amazing in this, in no fewer than three languages, and I still don't feel like I'm totally certain what is the real story here, which is part of why I love this film, too. Okay, my number three is The Myth of the American Sleepover. The feature debut from writer-director David Robert Mitchell follows a group of kids over one night at the end of the summer. Not a single moment here rings false. There's a hazy energy that lulls you, a leisurely pace to the dialogue, and the fact that Mitchell has cast all unknown actors adds to the feeling of authenticity.
We're gonna go to some tunnels one of the girls heard about. It's a makeup maze.
Can we go?
Do you know where the Abbey twins are?
I told you, they're starting school. Some freshman welcome sleepover.
What are you doing here?
I saw you and I thought I'd say hi.
Really?
This is a quietly observant, gently insightful film. You may think you know this formula, and the influence of American Graffiti is clear, but the rhythms and the naturalism make The Myth of the American Sleepover feel like its own refreshingly new entity. You can feel the yearning in every frame, the angst, the need to belong, to be understood and loved. Mitchell's little movie is pretty much perfect in depicting youthful imperfection. If you're one of the many people who may have missed it, here's how you can see it. It's available now on Netflix and on DVD in February. Number two on my list is one that inspired one of the more spirited debates between me and Ignatiy. It's 50-50, a comedy about cancer that manages the tricky feat of finding just the right tone every time. Joseph Gordon-Levitt stars as a young man with everything ahead of him who learns he has a rare tumor on his spine, one that he has only a 50% chance of surviving. Seth Rogen plays his best friend, who tries to be helpful in his own way.
It's not that bad. That's better than I thought.
You can be fine, man. You're young. Young people beat cancer all the time. Every celebrity beats cancer. Lance Armstrong, he keeps getting it.
Yeah.
He's fine.
Yeah.
Guy from Dexter, he's
right.
Okay.
You're gonna be fine.
Yeah.
You're gonna be fine. 50-50. If you were a casino game, you'd have the best odds.
Yeah.
50-50 will be out on DVD and Blu-ray in January.
Well, you know where I stand on 50-50. Mm-hmm. But your number three pick, The Myth of the American Sleepover, I think it's a wonderful movie.
Good.
It was very overlooked this year. And you are right about with the sense of naturalism, the realism that the cast and their performances really brings to that film. Well, my pick for number three is Pedro Almodovar's The Skin I Live In, a film that I really wish we had a chance to revisit on our show. You see, Christy saw it a while before I did. She reviewed it on this show solo, gave it a thumbs down, and called it a rare miss for Almodovar. So imagine my surprise when I finally saw the film and discovered that not only was it a great movie, but it was one of Almodovar's best, and one of the best of the year. Antonio Banderas, in the finest performance he's given in a very long time, plays a plastic surgeon who's keeping a mysterious woman, played by Elena Anaya, prisoner in his home.
Soy tuya. Estoy hecha a tu medida. Y acabas de decirme que te gusto.
He dicho eso.
Sé que me miras. Desde que me trajiste aquí, prácticamente vivimos en la misma habitación.
Tension and mystery build until, at around the halfway point, the film rewinds several years. As we learn the backstory to the relationship between Banderas and Anaya, their characters are completely reinvented. Almodovar has always been interested in questions of gender, sexuality, and how people construct their identities. This is his clearest expression of those themes. And he's such a superb stylist, with a palpable love for the craft of filmmaking, that he manages to wrap all of these heady ideas into a very meaty, entertaining revenge story. At number two is Bertrand Bonello's House of Pleasures, a wildly imaginative drama set entirely within the confines of an upscale brothel in Paris around 1900. It's not only a virtuoso piece of filmmaking, incorporating visual tricks, dream imagery, and even anachronistic rock music into its style, but also a deeply affecting and ultimately tragic film about a group of women who are able to form a tenuous bond thanks to a system that routinely exploits and brutalizes them.
Si nous ne parlons pas, comment éclairer la nuit?
La maison, elle va fermer? Je sais pas.
Et ce soir, il va falloir montrer un peu de joie, s'il vous plaît.
Yes, madame.
Indebted to their madam and looked down upon by the very men who come to them every day, the characters of House of Pleasures are sad, sympathetic figures for whom the opulent brothel is at once a prison and their only hope for survival. I found the ending of this film to be completely devastating. There's nothing that I've been moved by as much this year as the last minute of this movie, which is one of many reasons why I think it's simply one of the year's best.
Well, I'm glad that you caught up with The Skin I Live In and that you enjoyed it so much. I found it a little too pristine and kind of cold to the touch, but it's very pretty. We can agree on that. Now it's time, da-da-da-da, for my pick for the year's best movie. Martha Marcy May Marlene is a haunting, beautifully crafted bit of storytelling with a star-making lead performance from Elizabeth Olsen. She plays a young woman fleeing a seemingly idyllic farm in upstate New York. She reaches out to her estranged older sister, played by Sarah Paulson, for help. At this point, she's known as Martha, but flashbacks reveal that she's been living in a cult where an excellent John Hawks is the creepy, charismatic leader.
Look after this girl. For once in her life, she deserves some real care.
I will. She's been great. Everyone's been really great.
Good. Martha. You look like a Marcy May.
Marcy was my grandmother's name.
Wow. There you go.
Writer-director Sean Durkin cut seamlessly between Martha's time in the cult and her awkward attempts at living a normal life now, as the psychological abuse of the past and the paranoia of the present converge and collide. Martha Marcy May Marlene builds to a gripping, terrifying climax. Olsen is tremendous here, full of subtlety and torment. She's a real find.
Sometimes I just think I should have come home and made sure you went to college. You had so much potential.
You know, I don't need your guidance now, and I didn't then. I am a teacher and a leader. You just never let me be that, but now I am. I know who I am.
She's a younger sister of twins Mary-Kate and Ashley, but we won't have to think of her in terms of her more famous siblings for long, I don't think.
I've got a question for you about
Ask
your
me
list.
A question, yes.
Of the five films that you've chosen, three, Bellflower, The Myth of the American Sleepover, and your number one, Martha Marcy May Marlene, they're all by first-time directors.
Ah.
Do you think that's...
Very perceptive of you.
Very perceptive of me. Do you think that that's because it's been a very, maybe a weak year for established, well-known filmmakers, or that it's been a great year for independent filmmaking in this
country? I like your question. I kind of both. Maybe. I mean, I did have a hard time narrowing down my list, but I happened to see Bellflower and Myth of the American Sleepover back-to-back in the same day, in the same screening room. And I walked out of there so inspired and so full of hope for independent film and for original storytelling that maybe it is more the latter, that there are new voices coming out and there are more opportunities to see them and hear from them.
Well, my pick for the best film of the year so far is a movie that I consider a masterpiece. It's such an astounding achievement in storytelling, filmmaking, you name it. I think that if there's one thread that runs through the best movies of 2011, or what I think happen to be the best movies of 2011, it's that they're all to a certain degree about imagination and about how we imagine ourselves. Mysteries of Lisbon puts imagination front and center. It's about how people tell stories, how they invent new identities for themselves, and ultimately how the whole business of storytelling works.
Havia no colégio de Padre Diniz uma porta hermeticamente fechada que ninguém tinha o direito de abrir.
Mysteries of Lisbon is funny, lively, full of crazy plot twists and flashbacks within flashbacks within flashbacks. It was directed by one of the most imaginative filmmakers who ever lived, the late, great Chilean director Raul Ruiz. Ruiz was diagnosed with liver cancer while making Mysteries of Lisbon, and it seems like he intended the film to be a summary of his career. It's rich with ideas and clever tricks, and in the end, it's deeply moving.
This is a very bold choice on your part, which does not surprise me at all, knowing you and your eclectic tastes. I'm still not sure that I know what Mysteries of Lisbon is about. I found it really hard to follow, kind of baffling. I kind of need a flow chart or sticky notes or something to explain who everybody is and how they're all related to each other.
Everybody is several people.
Everybody's
and they all
named
have different
Pedro
story.
At some point. Everyone, what? They're all a pirate at some point?
Everybody becomes a pirate at some point in the movie. I mean, they're...
Were you confused watching it the first time? And it's 4 hours long. You should mention it's 4 hours long.
It's 4.5 hours, and it's got as much plot and action and comedy as a 30 hours of film.
You weren't lost at all watching this the first time.
I was blown away, is what I was.
Okay, what are Roger's selections? He's in his office with his top five.
This is Bill Curtis speaking for Roger Ebert. Number five on my list of the year's best films, Jeff Nichols' Take Shelter, with Michael Shannon's brilliant performance as a man whose dreams convince him catastrophe will harm his family. Number four, Martin Scorsese's Hugo, the magical story of a young boy whose secret life inside a Paris train station leads him to meet an old man who, when he was young, was one of the inventors of the cinema.
Fix it. I know you've been stealing parts from the shop. Might as well use those you haven't stolen yet. You've got a bit of talent.
Third on my list, Terrence Malick's visionary The Tree of Life, in which a typical Midwestern family lives for a summer in an instant of time, surrounded by the birth and death of the universe.
There are two ways through life. The way of nature and the way of grace. You have to choose which one you'll follow. You'll be grown before that tree is tall.
Second place on my list, Shame. Director Steve McQueen's merciless drama about sex addiction, starring Michael Fassbender as a man whose sexual obsessions cut him off from ordinary life.
I'm trying to help you.
How are you helping me, huh?
You come in here and you're a weight on me. You're a burden.
You want to get out of here?
We're family. We're meant to look after each other.
Romeo! Oh.
Brandon, please, will you pick up the phone?
And number one, the best film of 2011, A Separation, directed by Asghar Farhadi. The struggle for child custody leads to a tangled debate about the Iranian law and Muslim religious restrictions.
You made your wife a promise. You said you
من زدمش.
بچه بردنش بیمارستان.
یه خانمی آوردن امشب اینجا به اسم راضیه.
بچهش سفت شده.
چی کارش کردی مگه؟
شفاف توضیح بده آقا. اتهامش من اون قتل.
Everyone in the film seeks the truth, but no one finds it.
Thanks, Roger. Quite a few films that we also, I think, both like on there, especially Take Shelter, Roger's number five pick.
Right. Michael Shannon's amazing in that the skies are just so ominous and beautiful. And another film like Certified Copy that maybe you could interpret many different ways and not necessarily know what the truth is there.
A film about the imagination.
There you go. Okay. Now it's time for a look at the worst movies of the year. And my pick for the absolute worst of 2011 is really about the start of 2012. It's New Year's Eve, the latest star-studded holiday-themed extravaganza of schmaltz from director Gary Marshall, who annihilated Valentine's Day last year. Robert De Niro, Halle Berry, Hilary Swank, Josh Duhamel, Lea Michele, Michelle Pfeiffer, Jessica Biel, Sarah Jessica Parker, John Bon Jovi, they're all here, looking for love and whatnot. It was so hard to pick just one clip to show you how awful this movie is, but I went with this one. Enjoy.
Look out!
that?
Oh, God, no, don't.
I hated him for leaving me like that.
Not under the air.
And then he just shows up on the biggest night of my career. What kind of karma is that, huh?
What? That you made love with Jensen or that you're catering the biggest party in the city? Because all I'm hearing is good.
New Year's Eve bops aimlessly between various subplots with no regard for cohesion or tone. One minute, Zac Efron and Michelle Pfeiffer are zipping around Manhattan on a scooter. The next minute, Robert De Niro is dying of cancer in a hospital bed. It's like some sort of exercise in Dadaist stream of consciousness filmmaking, but that would suggest artistic intent. I kept asking myself whether I'd want to see any of these stories expanded into its own film, but it's hard to tell because they're all so cliched and shallow, and it's not even bad in a fun way.
It's just an absolutely awful movie. As is my pick for the worst film of the year. Now, to decide what the worst movie of the year was, I had to think really hard. After all, I have to admit that I did enjoy a good 30 seconds of The Hangover Part 2. So what film did I really enjoy watching the least? And what trend in filmmaking did I find the most egregious? Well, one movie happened to answer both of those questions. A documentary advocating vegetable-based diets called Forks Over Knives.
The other complaints, you had low energy, ringing in the ears, sinus problems, postnasal drip, shortness of breath, wheezing, coughs, indigestion and reflux, loose stool, diarrhea, bloating, black and bloody mucousy stool with meat consumption, and difficulty walking, getting around, trouble losing weight, chronic and unpleasant hunger feelings, groggy after meals, strong food cravings, and anxiety about food in general. All of that stuff.
Sounds like I'm dead.
Here's a tip to all of you prospective documentary filmmakers out there. Movies do not just make themselves. The badness of this film has nothing to do with its subject matter. Like a few too many recent topical documentaries, it's got a topic and no documentary. Forks Over Knives combines the scope and insight of a two-page brochure with the visual sophistication of a PowerPoint slideshow. It's bland, it's hectoring, it's repetitive, and it was, frankly, the single most boring thing I saw this year in a theater. I wish I'd fallen asleep during this movie and dreamt of something better.
Forks Over Knives is so bad, I went out and ate a cheeseburger afterward. That's how ineffective it was. I was so hungry for a cheeseburger the whole time. It's all I could think about.
And yet it became a modest hit.
Did it really? People went and saw Forks Over Knives?
Many, many people.
I'm very confused about this. Okay, now let's go to Roger's office for his pick for the worst movie of the year.
My choice for the year's worst movie was easy to make this year. It is The Human Centipede Part 2. The film is reprehensible, disgusting, ugly, artless, and an affront to any notion, however remote, of human decency.
Is this a perverted film you've been talking about?
This isn't right, Martin. What you're doing, it's wrong.
Thank you, Roger. And Human Centipede 2 is an excellent pick. If we had time to pick the five worst movies of the year, it definitely would have been on my list.
It could have been a contender.
It's so bad. And the first one's not bad. The first one's kind of suspenseful and shot beautifully.
But I think what makes the second one so bad is that it's not that it's tasteless. It's that it's incredibly dull.
And it's just trying too hard to shock us in black and white. It's not artsy, though.
Now, to recap our lists for the best of the year, my top five of the year were: number five, The Tree of Life. Number four, Certified Copy. Number three is The Skin I Live In. Number two is House of Pleasures. And my pick for the best movie of the year is Mysteries of Lisbon.
My top five films of the year are, at number five, Bellflower. Number four is The Tree of Life. Number three is The Myth of the American Sleepover. Number two is 50-50, and my pick for the best movie of the year is Martha, Marcy, May, Marlene.
And Roger's picks for best of the year are number five, Take Shelter, number four, Hugo, number three, Tree of Life, number two, Shame, number one, A Separation.
And for the worst movie of the year, my pick is New Year's Eve.
And number one on my list of the worst movies of the year is Forks Over Knives.
And Roger's pick for the worst movie of the year is Human Centipede 2.
Well, I think it speaks to the diversity of opinions on this show, and also to just how many great films there are out there, that there's only one movie that appears on all three of our lists, and that is The Tree of Life. Mm-hmm. And finally, we've got a few words from our executive producers, Chaz and Roger Ebert.
This has been a wonderful adventure, and one with deep meaning for me. I consider the show a great success in proving there is a national television audience for serious film criticism. And I want to sincerely thank you, the viewers, and Christy, Ignatiy, and all of our talented correspondents, and the entire Chicago-based staff and crew, some of whom started with Gene and me in 1975. Most of all, I am grateful to Chess. See you at the movies.
We'll keep you posted at RogerEbert.com, at EbertPresents.com, and our Facebook page, Ebert Presents at the Movies. Until then, the balcony is closed.
For more reviews and more from Roger's office, visit our website at ebertpresents.com.